Welcome everyone who is joining us on this call for, I hope, a very lively introduction to Krishna's special qualities or opulences in Vrindavan. Before starting, I would like to offer my most humble obeisances to Srila Prabhupada. If you know the verses, please join me. Namo Vishnu Padaya Krishna Prishtaya Bhutale Shimate Bhakti Vedanta Swami Nitinamine Namaste Sarasvati Devi Gauravani Pracharine Nirvishesha Shunyavadi Paskatyaji Shatarine. Hey Krishna Karuna Sindhu Dinabandhu Jagatpate Gopesha Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namostute Tapta Kanchana Gaurangi Radhe Vrindavaneshwari Vrishabhanusuti Devi Pranamami Hari Priye Sri Krishna Chaitana Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhara Shivashadi Gaur Bhaktavinda Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. When I received the invitation for this online retreat, I first thought, oh, another of these millions of online retreats which are going on at the present moment. But as I looked very closely at the motto or the subject, I thought, wow, this is a different online retreat because we are speaking very personally, very directly about Krishna, his pastimes. And in this way, we do what I would like to call therapeutic hearing. When you go to any therapy, at the moment you start the therapy, you will not always see the immediate benefit. The benefit of a therapy makes itself known really only after some time. After 1 week, 2 weeks, some therapies take even longer. So when you hear about Krishna personally, directly, you may in the beginning not feel the immediate benefit. In fact, because Krishna Katha may be so unfamiliar to you that you feel almost a little bit, it's over your head. It's almost like when you don't know anything about tennis, when you hear about tennis and that there's this move and this scoring and that special beat, you will think, oh, this is too much because you have never heard about it. But with time, you understand. In the same way, Krishna, hearing about Krishna's pastime, at the beginning is quite unfamiliar, because Krishna acts so totally outside of the box. He is so absolutely unique in what he does and how he thinks, that it may be difficult to relate to you. And that's why we call it therapeutic hearing. You have to hear it like a therapy against your forgetfulness of Krishna. And as you continue to hear, even in the beginning with some reaction that, wait a minute, this is over my head. As you begin, as you continue to hear, great effects take place. You lose your forgetfulness of Krishna, and you begin to actually become attached to Krishna. And with that, starting and slowly increasing attachment to Krishna, you lose your attachment to the world of harmful attachments, the world of Maya. Srila Prabhupada talked about this when he published his Krishna book. Imagine, at that time, no one really knew about Krishna. Prabhupada needed to explain, who is that girl next to Krishna? telling this is Radharani. Then when he finished the Krishna book, and when he was in the 19th chapter, he turned around and he said these words: the transcendental pastimes of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Sri Krishna, are so powerful that simply by hearing, reading, and memorizing this book, Krishna, one is sure to be transferred to the spiritual world, which is ordinarily very difficult to attain. The descriptions of the pastimes of Lord Krishna are so attractive that it automatically gives us an impetus to study repeatedly. And the more we study the pastimes of the Lord, the more we become attached to Him. This very attachment to Krishna makes one eligible to be transferred to the spiritual world. This is therapy. You who are a lost soul, you who have been, what is this English word called? You are exiled from the spiritual world. You are getting back your very good attachment to Krishna. And as a result, you are able to go back home, back to Godhead, just by hearing. Please understand, as we will now go directly into Krishna's wonderful qualities, that what we will be doing here is we are giving you the therapy which you need to return back home, back to Godhead. This is a worthwhile project, isn't it, Siddharth and Natasha? You must agree with me that this is a good investment of your time. This is awesome, as the young people in London would say. You must know that Krishna has many forms, and they are not different from each other. The Brahma Samhita gives the example: if I light a candle from another candle and then light other candles from that second candle, they all have the flame. They are all fire. Still, there's one original candle. So in the same way, there's one original Lord, Krishna, but so many forms have come from him, and they are non-different from each other. But that original form, Krishna, has one particular, unique, distinguishing feature. That is, he is the embodiment of love, the embodiment of rasa. Rasa means a great taste of transcendental happiness. And it is this which everyone is after. If you would now go on the streets of London, post yourself with a microphone on the bridge, which that famous bridge which goes over the Thames, I think it's called Thames, yes. And you would stick a microphone in the air. Well, maybe no one is on the street because of this present situation, but on a normal day, and you interview people, what is it that you really want in your life? You would hear from them happiness. You would hear it in different ways. I want money. I want success. I want to show my worth and prove my abilities. But behind all this is the search for happiness. The Taittiriya Upanishad mentions different levels of happiness by comparison. It says, imagine a young man, he studies the Vedas and is so good in it that he can teach it. He knows everything, in other words. He's healthy, he's physically able body, has an able body, he's mentally strong. And due to his tremendous qualification, he becomes the ruler of the earth with untold riches. Now, you must multiply his happiness with the number 10,000. And then you get the happiness which the Gandharvas, the beings on the higher planets, feel. But they have an additional quality of being invisible when they want. They're very long-lasting bodies, imagine, which don't sweat, and they don't need to go with them in this embarrassing small little room where there is, where all of us turn into fragrance makers. And they have an ability to enjoy sexual pleasures to a degree that is unknown to this, to the residents of the earth. So take their pleasure and multiply it with the number 100,000. Then you might arrive at the happiness of still higher beings who live on Brahma's planets. But if you multiply their pleasures with a number of, again, 100,000, and, then one day you will arrive at the pleasures of the Brahmananda, those who are absorbed in Brahman. But even they, if you multiply their happiness a millionfold, still you cannot compare it with even a drop of happiness that you obtain when you perform devotional service to Krishna and have his darshan. It is not possible. Therefore, those who saw Krishna, they would say, wow, we don't want to have dominion over the earth. We don't want to have Indra's position. We don't want to have unlimited powers for enjoyment. We don't want to have mystic power. We don't want Brahma's position. We don't want immortality. Even the Vaikuntha planets are not of interest for us. All we want is to look at Krishna, because that is the highest pleasure. Just imagine that by the simple act of gazing at Krishna, you have more pleasures, more happiness than being a Brahman realized soul, being a Gandhava on a higher planet, and having untold material opulences. Krishna is so very attractive that even his other forms, like Narayan, they want to simply gaze at Krishna. When someone gazes at you, you become uncomfortable. You know, when you drive in a car, and there is a car next to you, and the person always gazes at you, you feel like, ooh, and you go like, ma, don't gaze at me any longer. Gazing, finished now. You can gaze at Krishna unlimitedly long, and he doesn't feel at all inconvenienced. He feels that's good, that's a natural activity of the soul, to gaze at Krishna. So, my dear devotees, there are four specific qualities of Krishna that he exhibits that make him different from any other of his forms, like the Narayan forms and so on. These four particular qualities are unique to Krishna, and he only shows them in the happy land where he feels totally at home, the land of Vrindavan Dham. His first form, there are four qualities, and his first quality is called Lila Madhurya, or uniquely sweet and astonishing pastime. It's unique. Only Krishna has these Lila Madhurya qualities. What makes a person sweet? It's his submission to those who love him. And Krishna is so sweet because he is absolutely submissive to his devotees in Vrindavan. When his father says, bring me my chapal, my shoes, Krishna takes the shoes and he puts them on his head, and he comes going to his father and said, Baba, father, I have brought your shoes. Then Nanda Maharaj may say, bring also this vessel, you are very good in carrying items. But when the vessel is a little bit more heavy, and then Krishna just moves his hands like this and says, too heavy, too heavy, too heavy. But he tries to bring. That is how submissive he is. But of all the various pastimes, the pastimes which he does in his Rasa Lila, the circle dance, is most sublime, because there he becomes so submissive to the gopis that he dances with each one of them. For this he expands just to give pleasure to each single one of his devotees. Once there was a devotee who was discussing with another devotee about this pastime, and he said, I know about Narayan, the husband of the goddess of fortune, and I also know of other incarnations of the Lord. Certainly, all these pastimes are very exciting to my mind. Certainly, yes, yes, yes. But still, the pastimes of the Rasa Lila performed by Lord Krishna himself are wonderfully increasing my transcendental pleasure. You know, why is it increasing the pleasure of the devotees so much to hear how Krishna dances with his dearest devotees in the midst of the forest of Vrindavan at night time. The reason is a given. We as conditioned souls are very attached to social events. And if there's a joyful dancing with beautifully dressed people who are willing to dance and willing to associate, it's a very attractive scene. But unfortunately, the heart becomes contaminated with sinful desires to enjoy materialistic pleasure, which always bring us to the misery. But those who faithfully hear about the dealings between Lord Krishna and the gopis in the Rasa dance attain to the perfectional stage of devotional service, and simultaneously they lose the terrible grip of material desires over their hearts. They become free from this. They think, oh, my material desires are not so important. They become pure in their heart and think, oh, one day I would like to be together with Krishna, and I would also like to dance with him. See, we are, as Prabhupada says so nicely, we are like sparks of the original fire, but we have now fallen out of the fire, and we struggle for our existence. Even when we try to enjoy a ball dance or a party dance, however, if the spark, or if we become rejoined with Krishna, like the spark which re-enters the fire, then we dance jubilantly in the fire. When the spark falls out of the fire, it becomes black charcoal. You know, it makes a few more seconds a sound, pat 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 pat, and then poof, it's black and charcoal. Yes, in material life, we make a little sound, oh, so nice, it's so nice, it's so nice. But after some time, because it cannot fulfill our innermost desire, the desire of the soul, we are black with frustration. I have seen you in London. I have seen many black faces running over Oxford Street, charred, burned from their not at all successful endeavors. So, yes, all the activities of the avatars are very pleasing for the mind. How Lord Varaha lifted the earth planet, very pleasing. How Lord Nrisimhadev took such excellent care of Hiranyakashipu, very pleasing to hear. But when you hear about Krishna's pastimes, something very, very useful happens. You lose that grip of the terrible demon called lust on your heart, and the dirty things in the mind vanish. Shukadev Goswami expresses in the Bhagavatam, the 7th chapter, the benefit of hearing. He says, when one hears about Krishna, the attachments for material things, which is the root cause of material existence, vanishes, and the following effects come. First, one feels inspired for devotional service. Second, one becomes attached to Krishna. I want you, Krishna. Then one is able to develop real lasting friendships with devotees who give us the contribution of Krishna consciousness. Good. So the pastime of Krishna, they are uniquely sweet, because in all of these pastimes, you see how Krishna becomes submissive to the devotees. I remember how Prabhupada gave a little illustration of this, how we feel when a great man becomes submissive to a smaller man. He told about one secretary of state who came with a very important request to Great Britain or England, and he wanted to meet the Minister of Foreign Affairs, Mr. Gladstone, and discuss some request his country had. However, the secretary who received him at the appointed time said, "Wait, the minister is very busy at the moment with some very urgent work." So the secretary of the foreign country waited. Then he said, "I'm sorry, I need to catch the flight back to the country." The assistant of Mr. Gladstone said, "I cannot disturb the minister. He has such urgent work. It is, you just postpone the flight. You wait here and take the following flight." Okay, he waited another hour. Then again, "Oh, so much time is passing, so much time, please." By that time, the assistant of Mr. Gladstone was not there. So very carefully, the foreign secretary opened the door to the working room of Mr. Gladstone. And what did he see? Mr. Gladstone was on all fours, hands, two hands and two knees on the ground. His little grandson was riding on him, and they said, "You slow horse, you are very slow. Speed up, we have to win the race here." And Mr. Gladstone's head was already red, and he perspired profusely, but he followed the command of his grandson to win the race, the horse race. So that may endears us when we hear how a great man becomes submissive to a small man. That is very endearing to us. And Srila Prabhupada indicated that Krishna is doing this. He becomes submissive to the love of the devotees, as he did at the Rasa dance, when he danced with the multitude of gopis, fulfilling each single desire to have the personal association of the Lord, to be personally united with the Lord in a beautiful dance at the midst of the night, as the full moon was shining on the banks of the Jamuna, which was reflecting the light. It was very, very inviting, the scent. And now then, after the dance, Krishna retired with each one of the gopis to sit in the scent of the Jamuna and to engage in the loving exchanges of devotion. So another second quality of Krishna is his prema madhurya, that refers to his uniquely sweet devotees. Imagine you have a blue sapphire and you put him into a nice golden ring, a nice golden setting. At that time, the beauty of the blue sapphire is more accentuated. You can see very, very nicely the bluish diamond shining. It's more beautiful than if he would be just alone, surrounded with a golden setting. Oh, it becomes so beautiful. You say, wah, wah, so beautiful. So Krishna becomes beautified by his wonderful, sweet devotees. And Prabhupada writes about this also in the Nectar of Devotion. Whenever Krishna came back at the end of the day from the pasturing grounds, the gopis who had waited for Krishna so lovingly, they saw Krishna coming back. And as they looked from the windows, roofs, some even climbed towers, watchtowers. They were called moon towers because they really were very high towers. They were very, very attracted to Krishna. Krishna would walk into the village of Vrindavan, and the gopis would shower rains of flowers on Krishna. And on these flower petals, which were thrown at Krishna, they had written secret messages, letters, love letters. It was very small print, no? And some of the letters read, "Where will we meet? When will we meet?" And as Krishna received the shower of these flowers, he very quickly noticed the messages which were there on each rose petal and jasmine petal and all the petals. And by his eyes, much nicer than, or like this, by his eyes, he would answer all these millions of letters which came upon him, because he's Krishna. He can do very simple, very easily. So, at that time, the gopis were unable to stop to look at Krishna, but they took objection to the occasional blinking of the eyelids and condemned the creator, Lord Brahma, as a dunce. I do not know what this means. Dunce. Siddhartha, you know what that is? A dunce? Like a fool, huh? D-U-N-C-E. They cursed Lord Brahma. Oh, you are the fool, because you do not know how to make perfect eyes that don't blink. In other words, Prabhupada writes, the gopis were disturbed by the blinking of their eyes, because for the moment that their eyes were closed, they could not see Krishna. This means that the gopis' love for Krishna was so great and ecstatic that they were disturbed even by the momentary absence of Krishna from their eyes, when the eyes blinked. And when they saw Krishna, they were also disturbed, because Krishna is so beautiful, and when Krishna was absent from them, they were lying on the lying everywhere and suffering great pangs of separation. So you must agree, this is an amazing amount of love which you cannot find anywhere else, and that highlights Krishna's specific glory. His beauty shines forth more in the setting of these loving devotees. Of all of Krishna's devotees, there is one particular devotee whose love I would like you all to take in full notice. It is Srimati Radharani. And as you will hear her now speaking personally, and please watch for the love which is hidden in these lines. She says, "Since I have heard the name of a person called Krishna, I have practically lost my good sense." Since I heard the name Krishna, I have become so touched in my heart that I lost my good sense. Then there seems to be another person who plays his flute in such a way that after I hear the vibration of the flute, an intense madness arises in my heart. So she thought, this is a second person. Already I'm attached to the person who has the name Krishna. Then I'm attached to that person who is behind this flute playing. This is the second person. And again, there is still another person to whom my mind becomes attached when I see his beautiful lightning-like effulgence in his picture. You know, she is only attached to Krishna, but out of the intensity of her love, he thinks the person who has the name Krishna, the person who is playing his flute, and the person whom she sometimes sees in a picture are three different people. And she says, "Ah, I think I'm greatly condemned, for I have become simultaneously attached to three persons. It would be better for me to die because of this." What wonderful love, what wonderful attachment. And these are Krishna's devotees. They have this one thing in common. They just love him so much. When Krishna goes with his cowherd boys through the forest, they call out, "Oh, Krishna is just there." Oh, and then they cry because Krishna has just passed by the back of a tree, and for a moment they cannot see him. They go mad. "Where's Krishna?" And then they start to call to each other, "Let's run to Krishna. I will be the first one to touch him." And another says, No. "You are not so fast. I will be the first to touch Krishna." And in this way, they compete with their love. So when they look at Krishna as they walk through the forest, they notice by some indications, maybe some sweat over the brow, that Krishna is a little tired. The sweat is like whitish beads of sweat, which look very much like pearls over his forehead. And they think, "Krishna, you should lie down now. There's no requirement to move so fast and for such a long duration of time. Take some rest." And then the cowherd boys feel that they would like to offer their lap for Krishna's head to lie down. They feel, "Oh, he's our beloved Krishna." And now all these many, many, many cowherd boys have simultaneously the desire that Krishna puts his head on their lap to rest. For Krishna, this is not a problem. He immediately expands himself into as many forms as there are cowherd boys. And he lies quickly down on each of the many, many cowherd boys' laps without the one cowherd boy seeing that the other cowherd boy has also Krishna on the lap. Each one thinks Krishna is on my lap alone because he loves me very much. And in this way, many pastimes or snippets of pastimes could be narrated, which tell us how Krishna is surrounded by unique loving devotees, and how this sangha, or this association of love, brings out the unique qualities of Shri Krishna even more. My dear devotees, let us stop for a moment. Let us think of the incredible good fortune of Mother Yashoda, who wakes up Krishna in the morning. Let us think about the fortune of Nanda Maharaj, who goes with Krishna to the cow sheds to milk the cows in the morning. Let us also think about the good fortune of the cowherd boys who play with the Supreme Brahman in the forest of Vrindavan. And let us think about the fortune of the gopis. Krishna puts his hand on their shoulders, a fortune that was not even granted to the goddess of fortune, the Lakshmi. That shows you the loving atmosphere of Krishna in Vrindavan, together with his loving devotees, which makes it a unique second quality of Krishna. There is a third quality of Krishna. That is his Venu Madhurya, his incredibly sweet and all-attractive flute. No being in this world can compete with Krishna's musical genius, especially not with his flute playing. Even Shiva and Brahma, who are the originators of music, the science of music, they cannot comprehend how is it possible for Krishna to play these very beautiful music. You all have your music taste. I think many of you like hip-hop. Hip-hop? Is it hip-hop? There is a style. Others of you may like Celtic music from Ireland. But that's a little out of fashion. What music you like? Mindless music, not very mindful music, entertainment music, just to give some entertainment. Huh? But please know that all these music, someone may like hip hop, another may like classical Indian classical music from the court of the British crown, another might like Indian ragas, but no one can agree on everyone else's taste of music. But everyone and the mouse in his house will appreciate Krishna's flute music, because it directly attracts and pulls the heart. This is expressed also in Nectar of Devotion very nicely, the music of Krishna. In the 35th chapter of the Bhagavatam, we find this following scene. Mother Yashoda and all the household servants and are very eager for Krishna to come, and he's already a little late. So Mother Yashoda needs to hear some news, and she therefore sends the tallest gopi, very tall size, big size gopi, on the moon tower. She stretches her head, and then she sees a particular scene. She sees Krishna coming back, surrounded with all his cows, and he plays the music. But she also sees it on the side of the path, the left side and the right side of the path. There are the greatest demigods, even Brahma, standing there to to express their fascination to Krishna, how they feel when they hear or overhear Krishna's flute play. So the gopis tell Mother Yashoda, when your son plays on his flute, Lord Brahma and Indra, although they are supposed to be the greatest learned scholars and personalities, all become bewildered. Although they are all very great personalities, when they hear the sound of Krishna's flute, they humbly bow down and become very grave upon studying the various type of music of Krishna. Yes, they become so great when Shiva is dancing at that moment with his dindima drum. And he dances, and at that moment he catches the sound of Krishna's flute. He becomes stunned like a lantern in New York, stunned, not moving, standing there. The four Kumaras who were up till that time meditating very nicely when the sound of Krishna's flute enters their ears, they cannot continue their meditation any longer. It is not possible. Brahma was sitting on the lotus flower, engaged in creating the universe very meticulously, but when he hears the flute song, he has to discontinue creating. And who else? And Ananta Deva. This gets dramatic. Who was calmly holding all the planets on his hood, was moving in this way and in that way, being highly inspired by the by the flute sound of Krishna. So when there is an earthquake, it could well be that Ananta Deva has heard the sound of the flute music of Krishna, and he moves this way and that way, so that there is some movements. Krishna's flute music is amazing. Anyone who wants to study Krishna's flute music, I request you to go to the 21st chapter of the 10th canto. It's called Venu Gita, the song of the flute. It describes when Krishna enters the forest of Vrindavan, he takes on the position or the posture of a flute player. That means he takes his cheek and rests it on his left arm, and with the other, with the hands, he plays on the holes of the flute. Now Krishna's hands are not accustomed to work. Krishna creates by his will alone. He doesn't have to do heavy handwork. So when he moves deftly on the flute, the fingers all show a special indention, a little red circle, which makes his hands even more beautiful to look at. And as he continues to play, he has one thing in mind. He has just arrived in the forest of Vrindavan, and he knows the various animals are suffering due to intense separation from him. So when Krishna plays his transcendental flute, the pain of the separation is removed from the hearts of all those who waited for him. We hear that the flute sound, as it extends into the world, becomes the sound of the holy names. And if any soul in this world hears those holy names, his or her great separation from Krishna stops, especially when we hear it in a kirtan, we sing together, we feel in some ways, now I'm near Krishna. So Krishna plays his music to end the feelings of separations, which we as souls might suffer from. There is a great reaction in the forest of Vrindavan when Krishna plays his flute. First of all, the bamboo, the bamboo tree, yes, it sheds tears of separation. Jubilation is there. And the rivers become so jubilant that they grow instantaneously lotus flowers which open in full blossom. The reason is that the bamboo tree is the father of the little bamboo flute, and the river is considered to be the mother, you know, because with the water the bamboo has grown, which later became the bamboo flute, just like a son. With the breast milk of the mother, the son grows and becomes strong. So father and mother are always extremely proud when the son does well. So when the bamboo tree and the river hear that their descendant, the little bamboo stick, is touched by the lips of the Lord, they become so proud that they cry and make lotus flowers. That is how nice the sound of Krishna's music is. Peacocks dance madly so that the other creatures who see them become stunned. When the demigods cross with their vimanas over the sound where Krishna plays his flute, their wives become totally attracted to Krishna, and their cloth moves around. They become shy that maybe our husbands who are with us see that we are so attracted to Krishna, and they become envious on Krishna and angry at us, because right when they are there, our minds become taken away by Krishna. So they are little anticipating a heavy reaction of their husbands. But no, the husbands become also attracted to Krishna, and the vimanas stop. Imagine Krishna would play his flute over in Heathrow Airport. All the airplanes of British Airways would stop in the air. That would be quite a scene. That would be highly, highly attractive as the advertisement for British Airways. Our airplanes were stopped by Krishna's flute play over the Heathrow Airport. So yes, the cows and calves show reaction. The calves stop drinking from the udders of the cows, and the cows open their ears so that they catch the sound of Krishna's flute play like a cup, you know. Let me see if I have a cup for you. Boop. Like a cup which is used to catch some nectar. So the cup of Krishna, the cow's ears capture the nectar of Krishna's flute play. You must read this because it gets even more ecstatic. The trees start to tremble and dance. I can see in Siddhartha's wallpaper and in Natasha's wallpaper, you have the same taste. It's exactly the same wallpaper. There is a good sized tree. Imagine if Krishna's flute would come, that tree would start to dance, become uprooted. It is not a botanical problem for the tree. It would dance very elegantly due to the ecstasy of hearing Krishna's flute play. This is another unique quality. So I come now to the last opulence of Krishna in Vrindavan. It's the Rupa Madhurya, a uniquely sweet beauty. Normally, ornaments are worn to beautify the person who wears them, like a man might like to put something attractive in the earring, the lady might decorate herself with nice ornaments, golden chains, pearls, and so on. And this is done normally to beautify the appearance, so that more attractiveness will be displayed. In Krishna's case, you must know that the beauty of his body is so big that it can't be, nothing can be added by an ornament. No, the ornaments gain beauty by the simple fact that Krishna wears them. There was once a problematic discussion in Vrindavan. The gopis, the elderly gopis, had come to Mother Yashoda and said, we fear for the moral integrity of Krishna, because he comes to our houses, he very slyly outmaneuvers anyone and goes right into the storage room where our yogurt and butter is kept. And then he steals the yogurt and butter. The storage room is dark, says Mother Yashoda. How? What you say is false. He wouldn't be able to see anything in the dark storage room, said the gopis. He has these shining ornaments, arm rings, waist rings, then he has golden chains, he has a pearl in his nose, and by the light of the ornament he sees. But then the solution is very simple. I shall take his ornaments away, and then he cannot see anything, cannot steal anything. It's not that simple, say the other elderly gopis, because it is his beauty for body which lends light to the ornaments. So even if we take away the ornaments, he is so effulgent and he is so beautiful that nothing could happen. Many, many things have been written about Krishna's beautiful body, from toe to head. Devotees are encouraged to meditate about his beauty. Srila Vishwanath Chakravarti gave one a guideline for meditation, Rupa Madhurya, Rupa Chintamani it's called, where he describes every single part of Krishna's body. Especially he describes the smile of Krishna, which is It's so attractive. Krishna is known wherever he goes for his smiling. In fact, in the third canto it is said one should meditate about the smile of the Lord, which dries up the ocean of tears, which is cried by the conditioned souls who are feeling so much misery of material existence. Krishna's beauty is just wonderful and makes one forget all other beauty. We have beautiful deities of Radha Kanaya Lal. I don't know, God Krishna is here. Is it possible for us to blend in a picture of Radha? Or you can maybe bring a photo of Radha Kanaya Lal and we can share with the devotees. We have very beautiful deities and so on. Krishna's beauty is said to be so attractive that even he becomes attracted to his beauty. Prabhupada takes up this verse in the Nectar of Devotion, where he describes a scene where Krishna walks over the jeweled ground and sees the reflection of his own form there. I will read it to you. One day Krishna happened to see the reflection of his beautiful form reflected on the jeweled foreground. Upon seeing his own bodily reflection, he expressed these feelings. How wonderful it is that I have never seen such a beautiful form before. Although it is my own form, still like Radharani, I am trying to embrace this form and enjoy celestial bliss. So you can see Krishna's tremendous beauty. I'm under the care of these beautiful deities. Let me see that I can show it to you. Show them to you. Is it good? Can you see nicely?
Yes, Raj, we can. Thank you so much.
See the beautiful eyes of Radha Kanaya Lal. See the details of his head ornaments, his smile. Even a lotus feet are visible. Not so much, because that is there. This is the deity who is worshipped in our ashram. The name is, Radha Kanaya Lal. We are chanting our rounds in the morning, and each morning we are totally attracted to the beauty of his beautiful physical features. It is really like medicine. So, yeah, my dear devotees, these are visible qualities of Krishna. His uniquely sweet, astonishing pastimes, Lila Madhurya, the uniquely sweet devotees who surround him, Prema Madhurya, the uniquely sweet flute play of Venu Madhurya, and the uniquely sweet beautiful form of Rupaman Madhurya. But you must know, Krishna has many more qualities only in Vrindavan. Rupa Goswami says there are three types of qualities. Bodily qualities, verbal when someone speaks, and mental qualities. And I would just like to end this part where I directly talk about Krishna by highlighting what is in the mind of Krishna, what is in the mind of God. There were once two girlfriends of Radharani who were talking amongst themselves, what attracts you so much in Krishna? And they spoke about Krishna's beautiful mind. This one girlfriend said, I want to tell you, I like Krishna so much because his mind is so beautiful. Krishna becomes controlled by one who performs even the slightest or smallest amount of service. Oh, Dido, even the smallest amount of service, if someone does, Krishna becomes controlled. He will remember Tirupati Prabhu's cooking service. Even this, when he cooked this feast or that feast, Krishna remembers totally. But even if we cannot do so much service as our Tirupati Prabhu can do, even the smallest amount of service, Krishna can never forget that. And he always feels indebted. That is a mental quality of Krishna. The next quality the devotee mentions is he smiles patiently. Krishna smiles patiently even if an intolerable offense is committed against him. When someone commits even a small offense against us by misunderstanding us and calling us in a bad way, we become so unsettled and disturbed. But Krishna has such a nice mind that he simply smiles patiently, even if one commits an intolerable offense against him. What a beautiful mind he has. And the third mental quality, the quality of his mind, is his heart becomes tormented if he sees others suffering even slightly. Krishna doesn't immediately feel in his heart, oh, this person is suffering, I'm very sorry, and something should be done to alleviate his suffering. So this devotee who was speaking to the other devotee ends his that description. I can see that Krishna is so grateful for every little service. I can see that he is willing to forgive offenses done against him. And I can see that he himself takes the suffering of others so serious, he takes it to his heart. Therefore, when I consider this, my heart becomes thirsty for him. I'm so thirsty for him when I just think about Krishna's beautiful mental qualities. No? These are all the qualities of the Lord. And when we hear them, our hearts become soothed. We are in this world not finding any such beauty, not finding such love, not finding such flute play, for sure, and not such pastimes done. So if we hear more and more about it, our hearts become satisfied. Prabhupada says, when a person is under the hot Indian sun, oof, the whole day, oh, and he's dry and he's pained, and so on. Then when in the night the moon rises, he becomes cooled and refreshed. So we all in this world are so much frustrated, burnt in our attempt to find love, in our attempt to find beauty, in our attempt to find all these qualities which we have heard about, but we don't find them in this world and are frustrated. But if we hear about Krishna, that will be that suffering will go. It is saying, when a room is in darkness, if you can just find the one switch which will put light in the whole room, then your case is very good. So in our life, when we are in the darkness of material existence, blind, we have to somehow find the right switch that will turn everything. Ha! Here it is! And it turns bright and everything is very, very nice. So Prabhupada writes, the nectar of devotion. Now he writes like this, no one can live without loving someone else. The nectar of devotion will teach us how to turn the one switch, one switch, here it is there. It's a little bit hidden. This is the room of Gokrishna and he has a little hidden switch. The nectar of devotee, nectar of devotion will teach us how to turn the one switch that will immediately brighten everything, everywhere. One who does not know this method is missing the point of life. Prabhupada is very clear about this. He writes a nectar of devotion. So my dear devotees, I sincerely want to inspire you. You have now heard a beautiful, beautiful, beautiful retreat. I have carefully studied. There was Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu speaking. There was Umila Mataji. Who? The highly talented Amarendra was speaking. So much Madhur Katha was going on. I just see this in the comment section. Don't make this just a ISKCON London City retreat. It should go into your life. It should, you should from time to time read this beautiful book, for instance, The Nectar of Devotion, which will teach you to find that one switch that brightens everything in your life. You should find devotees who can speak nicely about Krishna. I think that on the internet we have so many options now to listen to so many devotees. This is the nectar of lockdown. The lockdown is no nectar, but we can find the nectar in the lockdown situation. And in this way, our lives can be soothed, our tears can be dried, and our attraction to Krishna can be increased more and more. Hare Krishna. I can go on, but I think I will turn to our Siddharth Prabhu. Siddharth Prabhu, I think we should now give some time for question and answers, or just tell me what, how should we do everything?
Yeah, so we've got one question at the moment. So perhaps, do you want to take the question now? And then if we don't have other questions, we can do a little bit more Katha Maharaj. How do you feel about
it? Yes, please. Let us hear your question.
Okay, so the question is from Kanchana Bailey Devidasi, which was related to the last point you mentioned, which is about lockdown. She says, Hare Krishna Maharaj, thank you for your happy and inspiring talk. During Krishna's pastimes, everyone had personal association with him. Unfortunately, these days, it is not that common for a personal meeting, especially with senior devotees. Is there any way to become closer to them, to render some service or help? Will you please give us any advice on this? Please, your servant, Kanchanabedi Devidasi.
Mm-hmm. Let me just clarify, during Krishna's presence here on earth, when he performed his pastimes, there were some devotees who had association with Krishna. So that is true. But then I think the question turned into, now we are in lockdown and we cannot meet devotees. So what should we do? My dear devotees, I was personally very much puzzled by this situation. See, when I joined Krishna consciousness, I actually became a devotee in London. Why did I become a devotee? Well, I had met the devotees in Germany, but I thought to myself, let me meet the founder of this movement and study him and see if I will be attracted to also become a devotee. So I waited, I visited the temple maybe once a week or maybe once every two weeks, but I wanted to make my decision how I would engage with the movement dependent on meeting Srila Prabhupada and the effect which that meeting had on me. So when I knew that Prabhupada would come to London, I traveled to London and I sat in his lectures and I had a few interchanges, small interchanges with him, exchanges with him, doing small services like this. And I became convinced. He personally took time to preach to me and solve a grave doubt which I had. And I surrendered my life to him and then joined our temple in Hamburg. That's a town in Germany. Now, when Prabhupada left the planet, I felt forlorn. I had only joined because of him. I had stayed in the movement because of him. And when he left, it seemed as if the ground under my feet was pulled away, and I felt helpless. I felt despondent. I felt this is my end in spiritual life. And at that time, there was a we did regular readings in the Bhagavatam. There was one reading that in the absence of the Vapu, the physical presence, you should, the disciple grieves. And then there was other parts which said, then the only opportunity the disciple has is to have association with the words of the spiritual master. So I became introduced to the concept of Vani. I learned that you can associate with Krishna by reading and studying his words in the Bhagavad Gita. And when you do this, you would have association with Krishna, just like Arjuna had association with Krishna. I heard such things, which I think all those who serve in our movement have heard. Two types of association: Vapu, physical association, and in the absence of that type of association, Vani, or hearing the words, the instructions. But I did not become fully convinced. I was still missing one piece of information, and I would love to share this piece of information with all of you. It's not just enough to hear the words, the instructions, the lectures, the katha of older devotees. That's good. That type of association is good, but it's not enough. Something is missing. What is missing is that you follow them and you execute them to your best of the ability. And you render service wherever you can. You can serve at home. There are many services you can do. Chanting is one service. Hearing about Krishna, you know, offering foodstuffs to Krishna. You must do practically something, and then the relationship becomes sealed. No? When there were letters in old England, there would be a seal which would be put on the letter to close the letter, and then it could travel. So when you want the Devani, the instructions, travel from this and come into your heart, you must put the seal of service on them. And then with that seal, the instructions can travel very freely and can inspire you. It's not just enough to hear. You need to serve. And then serve can mean you follow the instructions which you hear. And then a mystical connection, a mystical sealing takes place, which really connects you very, very nicely. That is a little bit my advice. Thank you for this wonderful question. So, yes, we should hear nicely, and then we should follow, take something to heart, follow it. Good. If there are no other questions, we have 4 more minutes. I would like to say something, Siddharth. Should I say it now, or?
Yeah, sure. We do actually have 2 questions, but up to you, Marge, if you want to say whatever you wanted to say.
Maybe we take 1 more question, and then I will say briefly what I wanted to say, which I think you will love very much. Mm-hmm. Please say.
So the question is from Mahaprabhu and Hema Mataji. Hare Krishna, Marge, please accept my obeisances. All glories to Prabhupada. Thank you for your wonderful class. How does one maintain constant remembrance of Krishna in the material world when there are so many distractions?
I would like to give you 3 suggestions. You might like to take your pen and your paper now. First of all, the way you start your day very much influences the rest of the day. So first thing which you do when you get out of bed in the morning should be you kneel down and you say a prayer to Krishna. That will inform that prayer, that short moment in the morning when you are connecting with Krishna, will ring through your whole day. Then, last thing you do before you go to bed, you can be already in bed, but sleep has not yet come. It is almost coming. Then you again pray to Krishna. Whatever I have done, whatever I have thought, whatever I have try to comprehend with my intelligence, I offer that to you, my Lord. Kayena vacham, anasendriya vaya. There is a beautiful prayer like this in the 11th canto. So if you do this, 1 second in the morning, first thing you get up, and the last thing which you do in the evening, you are already on the way of remembering Krishna. Really, there is a tunnel between the last waking moment in a day, that is when you are in bed. There's a tunnel which goes through your subconscious mind up to the first moment when you get up in the morning. And if you put in the tunnel some Krishna conscious information, you will have good Krishna conscious dreams, or at least not such confused dreams than if you don't do it. So that everyone can do. The last thing in the evening, when you are in bed, there is no distraction. Unless you have your TV on and you stay in bed and you look at the TV like the president of a certain country. And when you are in the morning getting up, there is also no TV or no nothing, no distraction. Turn in these two moments to Krishna. That is traditionally done. It is very nice. And during the day, try to dedicate your activities for Krishna. When you educate your child, try to do that to make him a devotee of Krishna. When you do something, you earn money, try to see, yes, I'm earning money, but part of, I will use it to strengthen my body and the body of and the family so that we can serve Krishna nicely. Try to dedicate whatever it is that you do for Krishna as much as you can. Your capacity is the English word. To think more of Krishna, however, will be trained in the morning by doing this simple morning ritual which I have suggested, and last thing before you go to bed. The more you do it, it will become natural to remember Krishna and not to react like a ping pong ball to all the distraction that beat your poor mind from left to right and so on. Haribo. So I want to thank you very much. I will just say one last comment here to all of you. It is very much my request to all of you. You have heard this Krishna Katha retreat by there were so many good speeches and lectures here for you. Please, 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 let that be an auspicious beginning of you hearing more and more of Krishna, so that you can remember him throughout the day. Most of the devotees of Krishna are never thinking of Krishna during the day. It's a scandal. A great scandal, actually. And that happens because it is, you're not regularly hearing about Krishna, then how will you remember? You will be distracted. So please do that in a regular way. It will be very good for you. I'm hearing here Jai, what? Jai Nitai is on online also. Jai Nitai, I have great happiness to just hear your good name. I'm a great fan of our Jai Nitai. I like Jai Nitai very much. Yes, I see you even. You are staying at Kusum Sarova at the moment, Jai Nitai.
I've just finished my parikram. I'm here at Kusum Sarova now.
Good, 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 good. That is very nice. Hare Krishna. So, good, my dear devotees. I thank you very much for participating. Our time is up. It was a genuine joy to speak with to be with you, being mindful of Krishna. All glories to Srila Prabhupada. Srila Prabhupada ki jai. Have a wonderful rest of the day.